And thanks for coming back, and welcome to the panel on Broadening Lenses, Major Turns in Holocaust Research. We have three distinguished panelists with us today, and let me introduce them in the order in which they'll speak, which is the order in which they're sitting next to me, or not. I'll introduce them now, and then they can sort of proceed one after the other. So Debórah Dwork, immediately to my left, is Rose Professor of Holocaust History and Founding Director of the Strassler Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Clark University, once extended an invitation to me to speak there, so I'm very grateful for that. Path-breaking in her oral history, early oral histories of Holocaust survivors, she weaves their narratives into the histories she writes. Among her award-winning books, Children with a Star introduced a child-centered approach to historical investigation. Her book, Flight from the Reich, opened the geographic view of the Holocaust and integrated the refugee experience into its history. And Auschwitz drew the critically important connection between industrial killing and a society that believed it was involved in constructive activity. Internationally renowned for her scholarship, she's also a leading authority on university education in this field. She envisioned and grew the Strassler Center into an eminent institute for doctoral training in Holocaust history and genocide studies. A member of the American delegation to the 31-state International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, she has been a Guggenheim Fellow, a fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, and a fellow of the American Council of Learned Societies. Dwork now serves as the Shapiro Senior Scholar in Residence at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. And we are very pleased to have her here today. Next, I'm going to mangle this name, excuse me, but my Hungarian is not very good. Zoltán Tibori Szabó is Associate Professor of Political Communication and Journalism at Babes-Bolyai University in Cluj, Romania. He's author of several books and many studies dealing with the Holocaust in Hungary and Transylvania, and is Director of the Institute for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Babes-Bolyai University. He's co-editor with our own Randolph Bram of the Geographic Encyclopedia of the Holocaust in Hungary, which appeared in English with Northwestern University Press in 2013, as well as of the Geographic Encyclopedia of the Holocaust in Northern Transylvania, which, as far as I know, is only available in Hungarian. So, and third and last but not least, of course, Natalia Alexiun is Associate Professor of Modern Jewish History at Touro College, Graduate School of Jewish Studies here in New York. She studied East European and Jewish history in Poland, where she received her first doctoral degree at Warsaw University, as well as at Oxford, Jerusalem, and New York, where she received her second doctoral degree at NYU. She also just told me she speaks half a dozen languages, which I can barely pronounce, much less speak. Her work focuses on modern Jewish history in Eastern Europe, especially the history of Polish Jews in the 20th century, modern Jewish historiography, and the history of medicine. She's published a monograph entitled Where To? The Zionist Movement in Poland, 1945 to 1950, and numerous articles in Yad Vashem Studies, Polish Review, Dapim, East European Jewish Affairs, Studies in Contemporary Jewry, Polin, Gal Ed, East European Politics and Society, Nashim and German History. She co-edited the 20th volume of Polin, devoted to the memory of the Holocaust, and the 29th volume, which is called Writing Jewish History in Eastern Europe. Her book, Conscious History, Polish Jewish Historians Before the Holocaust, will be published with Litman in 2018. She's currently working on a new book about the so-called cadaver affair at European universities in the 1920s and 1930s, as well as on a project dealing with the daily lives of Jews hiding in Galicia during the Holocaust. So we're very pleased to have these distinguished scholars with us today, and we're gonna start, as I said, with Debórah Dwork, who's gonna speak about a new turn in Holocaust scholarship, the role of the unpredictable and the irrational.
thank you very, very much for this wonderful invitation to come to speak today. It is a great honor indeed. And in her invitation, Patrizia, where are you, Patrizia? Yes, urged us to think about turns in Holocaust research. Her suggestion prompted me to discern a fairly clear trajectory of scholarship in the 70 plus years since the war ended, and it gave me a most welcome opportunity to speak about what I am busy with these days, which is the role of the unpredictable and irrational. I will skedaddle through the first phase, characterized by Raul Hilberg and dominated by the history of destruction. As we all know, in the late 1950s, Hilberg could not find a publisher. By the time the destruction of the European Jews saw the light of day in 1960, Adolf Eichmann was on trial in Jerusalem, which prompted interest in bureaucrat perpetrators. It spurred another turn as well. Jewish victims were publicly visible and vocal during the proceedings. And who at that time was writing about them? It took another decade for books about Jews to appear, and another decade after that for books about the neighbors of those Jews. Collaboration and collusion loomed large. It was in the context of this canvas of complicity that the role of ordinary people in local rescue efforts came to the fore. The Gentiles, as well as Jews who sought to rescue Jews, offered an alternative to a dominant narrative of conformity. By the 1980s, Holocaust research was well grounded in the norms and conventions of social history. If 30 years earlier, the Holocaust had been seen as the destruction of European Jews, new lenses differentiated that the experiences of that mass. Age and gender proved productive tools of analysis. A penultimate turn on this whistle-stop tour, the recent scholarship that situates the events we call the Holocaust in a broader picture of ethnic conflict and violence during World War II. Stepping back and widening our view allows us to see Jews as one group in a multi-ethnic society and helps us understand multi-layered mass violence, where interrelated and parallel episodes against different populations occurred on the same territory. The post-war period, the history of refugees, Holocaust memory, the geographic turn, all of these are key new developments. But I leave them as dotted lines for others to fill in. As I jump to what I see as a new turn in Holocaust scholarship, the role of the unpredictable and the irrational. As I mentioned, that is what I am busy with these days. Historians have shied away from the unpredictable. Timing, luck, chance, fortuitous circumstances. We don't know what to do with these factors, so we don't do much. Let me give you an example to illustrate my point. Hannah Starkman, then aged about 12, was with her mother and brother, her brother Heniek, in the German-imposed ghetto in the Polish city of Radom. One night, we heard shooting. We went to the window, and we saw people running and German soldiers shooting. We got dressed, and then a couple of minutes later, we heard Germans in the building yelling, "Raus, raus, raus." So we all went out, and there were masses of people in the street. You could go either to the right or the left from the middle of the street. We stood there for, I don't know, maybe half an hour. And then they told us to go back into our apartment. We didn't know what happened. We found out later. Radom had two ghettos, a small ghetto on one side of town and the bigger ghetto where we were on the other side of town. They sent out everybody from the small ghetto to the Treblinka annihilation camp. They had a few cars, those cattle cars, train cars left. So they needed some more people. So they got all the people from the big ghetto out on the street, and they counted how many people they needed. So some of our neighbors who, when they left the apartment house, went to the right, they were sent to Treblinka that night. And we, because we turned to the left, we were not sent out. The luck of the draw. So later on, when my brother came home from work and my neighbor's son came, he didn't find his mother and sister. My brother found us. It was just one of those things. I am not minimizing the importance of ideology, policy, and practice. Were it not for ideology, policy, and practice, Hannah, her family, the Jews of Radom, would not have been there at all. But at that very moment, luck, fortuitous circumstance, shaped her fate. So the slippery, less concrete or measurable, yet forcefully significant factors of timing, chance, and luck deserve our scholarly attention. And to complicate analysis further, let's go to the even messier role of emotions, human relations, the irrational. The turn to take very seriously the very factors, the unpredictable, the irrational, that we know shape our own lives, and for sure shape our political situation, but that's to the side. These very factors that we know shape our own lives, but we ignore when we look to the past and in our analyses of the past. We are very well aware of the ways in which irrational feelings, our own and those of others, how those irrational feelings affect us. But we impose a carapace of rationality on the past. My goal is to prompt all of us to reframe the way we think about, analyze, and write history. Not to marginalize the factors that we already have identified as significant, but to add another lens. Again, an example to illustrate my point. We're in Marseille, spring 1942. The American Friends Service Committee, the AFSC, or Quakers, headquartered in Marseille, teamed up with the United States Committee for the Care of European Children, USCOM, to organize the immigration of groups of children to the United States. Whom to choose? Preparing the fourth transport, Marjorie McClelland, a young woman, a young Quaker working there in her 20s, actually pregnant at that time, although none of her colleagues knew that. But we have the archival record, so we know it. Anyway, she reflected upon her calculus of decision making. "It has all to be done in a terrific rush," she wrote in April 1942 to Margaret Frawley in the Home Office in Philadelphia. "When your cable came announcing another convoy of 50 children and suggesting that I be given responsibility for selecting the children, it called for some deliberation. I had hoped originally to spend several days in each Ose children's colony observing the children at work and at play and talking to their teachers. In that way, I had hoped to make a sound evaluation of the children, even though I was not able to give them intelligence tests or make the selection on what could really be considered a sound psychological basis. The realities of my procedure were far different from my plans, because with the necessity for speed, it was necessary for me to make a lightning tour of the children's colonies, choosing the youngsters after only the most superficial consideration. McClelland set certain criteria. I had in mind two basic considerations: the necessity for emigration and the desirability of immigration of each child. I wished to satisfy myself, insofar as it was possible, of the child's desirability as an immigrant to America, that he was a normal, at least averagely intelligent, adaptable child who would be able to fit into an American family without too much difficulty. But life on the ground in Europe carried weight for her, too. I also took into consideration the situation of the child here in France, for obviously not all cases are similar. I considered the children who had lost one or more parents, children whose parents had remained in Germany or had been deported to Poland, children who were all alone without any family. These children have less future here and therefore have greater need for emigration to America than children of families who are here. Thoughtful and rational as these considerations were, the essentially emotional nature of her decisions courses through the short biographies of each of the 50 children she selected for the convoy that left Marseille on May 14, 1942. Henri and Miriam Mas, aged 6 and 8, respectively, serve as my example. Polish by nationality, they were born in Antwerp, where their parents owned a small restaurant. The family had fled to the south of France after the Germans had occupied the Low Countries in May 1940. The father, Samuel, was put to forced labor in January 1941, and the mother, Regina, and the children were interned in the transit camp of Rivesaltes. Marjorie McClelland met them there. "Regina Mas," she wrote, "seemed like a very nice, simple, earnest woman, very much concerned over her children. I thought it remarkable that she was so clean in the midst of the camp where cleanliness is so unbelievably difficult to achieve." And so we need to ask ourselves, what if Regina Mas had been a slob? What would have happened to those children? McClelland sympathized deeply with the victims. Still, it fell to her to choose. She applied a rational calculus that she laid out for her colleague, Margaret Frawley. Yet irrational factors held weight too. Sometimes even tipping the scales. At the safe distance of 3/4 of a century, we assume that social workers such as Marjorie McClelland relied upon a logical rubric. Her record offers a lens on the complexity of these choices and decisions. Age, gender, religion, social class, degree of peril, all of these played a role in her selection calculus. And so too did her feelings about and connections to the people who sought her help.
Let me first express my gratitude for all those guilty for inviting me here and having me here. It's an honor to speak in the front of you. I will give my thoughts about the collapse of the Soviet bloc and its impact on the Holocaust research and remembrance in East Central Europe. While remembering the dark side of the history of different nations regarding their attitude towards ethnic and religious minorities living on their national territory is quite difficult, it is also a very important initiative and action for shaping the collective ethnic and social identities of both majority and minority groups. Reconsidering, reworking, and teaching these uncomfortable parts of history with tools offered by scholarly research can lead to a process of coming to grips with painful historical facts and aspects that did not simply vanish from the conscience of perpetrators and victims, but are actually lingering legacies of shame, poisoning the complex relations between the two sides. I will try to review the main challenges of the research, remembrance, education, and memorialization of the Holocaust in the former East European socialist countries after the collapse of the so-called Soviet bloc. During the military actions that took place in 1944 and 1945, the liberating Allied armies revealed and exposed the horrible truth about the unprecedented genocide committed against the European Jewry. Designed and implemented by the German Nazis and their different East Central European henchmen, this truce did not astonish the conscience of the cooperating nations living in the region and did not trigger such a deep self-reflection process that would have completely abolished the racism and anti-Semitism. This is why in East Central European nations, the tragedy of the European Jewry did not end with the firm determination to never allow again the development of a political system that seeks the total destruction of a nation, of an ethnical or of a religious group of people based on xenophobia, racial, political, or religious intolerance. On the contrary, after World War II, anti-Semitism raised again almost immediately, even in the proximity of the gas chambers, crematories, mass killing sites, camps and ghettos where millions of Jews and hundreds of thousands of Roma and Sinti individuals suffered and died and led again very quickly to new criminal atrocities. The main reason was the presence of the so-called unwanted returnees, of a few Jewish survivors of death and forced labor camps who started claiming back their movable and immovable property according to the peace treaties of Paris, assets already appropriated by their former Christian fellow citizens and neighbors or by their national states. Step by step, the Soviet-type regimes that were implemented after the war in these countries convinced the survivors of the Holocaust to renounce to their claims, arguing that during the war everybody suffered, Christians included, and that eventually the remaining property will entirely and fairly belong to everybody, to all the members of the people and workers and peasants. After the consolidation of the proletarian dictatorship in East Central Europe, the majority of the survivors lost even the hope to continue their interrupted life and activity, and along the foundation of the new state of Israel, they decided to emigrate to the new old promised land of their ancestors. The remaining few understood that they will not be able to reclaim any Jewish property and that their ordeal is a subject which provokes tensions between them and the majority. Slowly but surely, the situation developed in what I am calling the great silence, the total silence surrounding the crime. Neither the victims nor the perpetrators have brought these questions forward. The memory of the victims was preserved only by extremely rare public and just a few private monuments erected by the survivors themselves immediately after the war on the walls or in the courtyards of synagogues, in Jewish cemeteries and community facilities. After 1948, the subject of the Jewish sufferance was constantly ignored. On rare occasions, the communist regimes mentioned, however, the anti-Jewish aggressions and crimes, but only in a general anti-fascist context on the Soviet model. Auschwitz, Treblinka, Sobibor, Dachau, and Buchenwald were described rather than death or forced labor camps where Poles, Russians, French, Italians, Hungarians, Slovak, and so on. So everybody, and also Jews, suffered and died. Even the books and studies published on the genocide directed against the Jews between 1945 and 1948 were closed in special sections of university and public libraries and were accessible to the researchers exclusively on the basis of special approvals. Under such conditions, it is not surprising that all that the Holocaust research has been conducted mainly abroad by scholars living in Western Europe, in the United States, Israel, or other liberal democracies of the world, and that the memorialization work within the frame of national borders of most of the East Central European countries was suspended for decades. The hope of change in the situation was only restored to the agenda by the collapse of the Soviet bloc. The series of regime changes in East Central Europe and the dismantling of the Iron Curtain that marked the end of the Cold War opened new perspectives for Holocaust research and remembrance. During the 1990s, some of the important East Central European archives were opened. This assured access of the researchers to extremely important and previously unknown documentary materials that allowed a deeper and more subtle knowledge of the nature of the fascists and Nazi regimes, a better contextualization of the regional events, and of the involvement of the local Christian populations in the Holocaust, and finally, provided a more precise picture of the Jewish responses to the acts of the Nazi persecution. The resulting scholarly work started to shake the proper foundations of the national myths, self-images, and identities constructed on the idea that the local non-Jewish populations were themselves victims of the Nazi regimes and rather heroic saviors of Jews than criminal perpetrators and unforgivable bystanders. The dark and troubling past, once unveiled, provoked shame and sentiments of guilt and regret in the conscience of the people, and was already searching, that were already searching the way to become a part of the collective memory. At stake were the design and construction of the new paradigms of national identity, and the failure of these efforts was not to be allowed by national forces that appeared after the collapse of the Soviet bloc as a whole, and of the local socialist regimes of the East Central European countries. The local responses aimed at creating positive, heroic, and general self-images and acceptable identities of the different nations living in the region, and distanced East Central European public discourses regarding the Holocaust from the Western European pattern. That's why I am not believing in this theory of Europeanization of the Holocaust research these days. Besides, the old forms of Holocaust denial, like the negation and the relativization, new forms were also crafted, like the deflection or comparative trivialization, as Professor Shafir mentioned in the morning, and what David Katz is calling the obfuscation of the Holocaust. Obfuscation includes the transformation of the local killers into anti-Soviet heroes, the blaming of victims and survivors, the deflation of the Nazi crimes, the inflation of the Soviet crimes, and eventually the equality between the latter two. New theories also emerged, for example, that of the double occupation and double genocide, already mentioned also today, which in various of its forms found home in several countries of the region, and all these reunited led to what Michael Shafir is calling the Holocaust Gulag competitive martyrdom. In East Central Europe, history of the Second World War and of the Holocaust is being rewritten to suit the nationalism-based identity-building efforts of the different countries of the region, to totally absolve of any guilt local collaborators, to emphasize only the saviors without even mentioning the nature of the threats and the identity of the perpetrators, and to proclaim communism and Nazism equal evils. Discourse has been raised during the past years to a European level, demanding not less that the common memorialization of the Holocaust and of the Soviet crimes, of the Nazi death and forced labor camps and mass killing sites on one hand, and the Gupvi and Gulag lagers on the other. The double genocide myth that posits supposed equality in principle of Nazi and Soviet crimes has come to have its own foundational document, the 2008 Prague Declaration, which demands that, and I quote, consciousness of the crimes against humanity committed by the communist regimes throughout the continent must inform all European minds to the same extent as the Nazi crimes, regime's crimes did. End of quotation. It is very important to state here again, as clearly as possible, that the two evils cannot be compared and measured against each other, and that this macabre accounting cannot lead the involved people to a peaceful coexistence and future. However, this situation did not stop the young generation of scientists from processing the released archival materials and from comparing their findings with the accounts of the survivors in order to write the true history of the Holocaust. After the majority of East European states became members of the NATO and the European Union, frontiers together with the university programs and research opportunities for young scholars were opened. Scholarships became available, and entire cohorts of young and skilled scientists came to Western universities and participated in their research programs. Nowadays, the studies and books of members of this young generation appear successively. They reveal the true nature of the Nazi and fascist systems, and detailing local events bravely face the dark sides of national histories and the collaboration of non-German populations with these criminal regimes. Unfortunately, a significant number of these young scholars did not return to their home country to have the high school and university education linked to the Holocaust and to contribute to changing of mentality of the new generation on the spot. The approach to Holocaust issues in East Central European states is slightly different. Researching local historiographies, scrutinizing the local Holocaust-related memorialization events, as well as local historical policies, one can easily see different approaches depending on the geopolitical lines followed by the states concerned. A serious difference in approach can be observed in the states that were part of the former Soviet Union, where the so-called Soviet legacy has a major impact on history as well. While former Soviet republics are marked by this legacy and are shaping their historical approaches accordingly, revealing some facts but hiding others, the countries that were only parts of the Soviet bloc are much closer to the European way of dealing with history and legacy of World War II. In their recent review of the current state of affairs in Holocaust historiography in Eastern Europe, Pfefferman and Kabalek came to the same conclusion. According to them, the images of the past of these countries, and I'm quoting, are narrated in relation to the concerns and orientations of the present, which include, on one hand, the promotion of globalizing memorialization standards that have emerged in the West, and on the other hand, the local traditions of historical methodology and factors of current politics. In my study in the written form, I am analyzing each country of the former Soviet bloc, Belarus, Bulgaria, Croatia, the Czech Republic, Estonia, Hungary, Latvia, Lithuania, Moldavian Republic, Poland, and Romania, and Russia, and Slovakia, and Ukraine separately. But due to the lack of time, I will jump to my conclusions. I have 2 minutes?
Three.
Oh, you are generous.
You've come a long way.
That's why I came for. The remembrance and memorialization of the Holocaust in the studied East Central European countries is closely determined by the above mentioned and detailed national historical narratives. Placing Nazism and communism on the same moral level, or even depicting Stalinism and the various post-Stalinist drives as worse than Nazism, is a common practice today in many formerly communist Eastern and Central European countries. Regarding Holocaust remembrance and memorialization, one can identify in these countries both positive and negative examples. In the former Soviet republics, one can identify, for example, remembrance strategies adjusted to the requirements of the double genocide theory, to the Soviet historical narratives, or only to scientific perspectives. There are, however, monuments and commemorative inscriptions in other countries of the Soviet bloc too that are based on the double genocide approach. The House of Terror Museum in Budapest, for example, led by Mario Schmidt, a revisionist Hungarian historian, adapted, for example, the double genocide model to the local needs of nationalists, anti-Semites and Nazi sympathizers, equalizing the Holocaust with the terror of the Soviet-type communist regime. The statue of St. George in the same town, already mentioned today, is deflecting responsibility to the Germans, while the Holocaust monument on the riverside of the Danube is a very impressive and truthful example of memorialization in the capital of Hungary. Positive examples of memorialization can be regarded the Holocaust Memorial erected in Bucharest, the Holocaust Museum and Memorial in Budapest, and the Memorial to the murdered Jews of Europe from Berlin. without in any way minimizing the oppression and the suffering endured by large parts of the population under communist regimes, it is beyond question that no post-World War II communist regime anywhere in Europe committed or attempted to commit genocide. To be precise, there were large-scale political imprisonments, far-reaching deprivations of civil and human rights, and politically motivated killings. However, as Yehuda Bauer stated eloquently in response to a 2009 resolution of the European Parliament determining August 23rd, the anniversary of the signing of the 1939 Nazi-Soviet Non-Aggression Pact as a date to commemorate the victims of both regimes, and I quote Bauer, to compare that with the murder of many millions of Europeans by the Nazi regimes, and especially with the state-planned genocide of the Jews in the context of Nazi crimes generally, is a distortion of history, end of quote. The comparison is especially invidious, as Bayer made clear, because a certain number of those persecuted by the communists, I am quoting him, had in fact been Nazi collaborators. One certainly should remember the victims of the Soviet regime, Bauer concluded, and there is every justification for designating special memorials and events to do so. But to put the two regimes on the same level and commemorating the different crimes on the same occasion is totally unacceptable. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. And I'm also very grateful for the invitation and being included in those discussions and in this panel in particular. And when the invitation came, it had an assignment of thinking about family turns. So I ran a quick poll among my Facebook friends who are Holocaust scholars if they think that there is a family turn. There was no clear result to that poll. So I will share with you more questions about it than a clear-cut argument for the existence of the said turn. More, I think, in continuity to what Debórah was discussing, it's one more way of thinking how we can think and research the destruction of European Jews, this huge topic. And I also want to introduce you to Polish accent. After all, the beautiful other accents today. In his 1945 outline of program for Holocaust research, Philip Friedman, a survivor and pioneer Holocaust historian, listed a section devoted to the Nazi persecution and its effects on Jewish life. It included categories such as biological and economic impacts, social and religious life, as well as resistance and fighting. Here he was developing his, what he called, Judeo-centric history of the Holocaust. More specifically, it urged future Holocaust historians, us, to examine the decrease in birth rate, dispossession and pauperization, plight of children and orphans, and more specifically, what Friedman called disintegration of the family. Indeed, already in the activities of the underground archive Oinek Shabbos in the Warsaw Ghetto, led by historian Emanuel Ringelblum, its members collected material that specifically illustrated the daily struggles of ordinary Jewish families and the ways in which pauperization, food scarcity, brutalization took a toll on their stability. Rachela Auerbach, Gustava Jarecka, and many other activists of the archives paid close attention to the transformation of Jewish families through the forced ghettoization, labor, and starvation. For Ringelblum and Friedman, The application of familial lens was necessary in order to examine intimate aspects of Jewish life and to document Jewish responses to persecution. Both in the systematic study of Jewish life under occupation, which Ringelblum called 2.5 years of the Nazi occupation, which was not finished, and in Friedman's post-war program, familial lens allowed scholars to discuss the destruction of European Jewry, to discuss the destruction of Jewish communities as the destruction of Jewish families. This pioneering approach to Holocaust research allowed and called for humanizing and individualizing the tale of collective suffering. And I thought about it when Wendy talked earlier about empathetic moralization that is part of our call. In the context of the early work, we can hardly speak of the familial turn in Holocaust scholarship. Rather, historians of the Holocaust have increasingly recognized the centrality of familial turn. There is certainly renewed interest that goes hand in hand and is reinforced by the use of Jewish testimonies, by gender analysis, and increased scholarly interest in examining Jewish agenda during the Holocaust. And Debórah's work comes to mind, Dalia Ofer, Jana Michlitz, Eliana Adler, Anna Haikova, and many others. And it's interesting that all the 10 first names that come to mind happen to be female scholars, but we can leave it for discussion later. By incorporating personal accounts, I really tried to find other. By incorporating personal accounts and close reading of victims' testimonies, and by focusing on familial relations, scholars pay closer attention to the victims' accounts of personal emotions, the Jewish efforts to come up with effective survival strategies, and Jewish understanding, self-understanding of resistance. Perhaps in the most challenging way, placing families in the center helps us not only to look at survivors, and especially for East Central Europe, we know that people who survive are, you know, the only survivor of a family, so this is usually the lens we take when we look at their testimonies, but there are survivors of families that existed. So when we look through that lens, I think we are inevitably looking at the ways in which Jews face death rather than get tempted to talk about happy end stories through stories of survival. And I want to briefly talk about three aspects in which I think familial turn is particularly useful. I will probably really get only to the first one, but I'll mention three: family networks, history of emotions, and micro histories of the Holocaust. As far as family networks are concerned, this familial lens, how they organized food supplies, shared foodstuffs, divided labor, tried to shelter those that were most vulnerable, at least up to a certain point, the elderly and the children. Family members helped one another when Jews were forced to move from their homes, when they were moved to other cities, when food supplies were running out, and family networks, even distant families, were trying to come up with ways in sending food. There is new research that is coming out by Marian Kaplan about packages sent from Portugal. Eliana Adler worked on packages sent to Generalgouvernement from Polish Jews who escaped to the Soviet Union during the period before the summer of 1941. Family networks are then key to understanding Jewish survival strategies throughout the Holocaust. In some accounts, family solidarity is explicitly credited when survivors sought to explain their own lack in staying alive. And it's a flip side of what, Debórah, you were talking about. There are really two ways in which people explain how they survived. Either this complete luck, fluke of luck, and the other is we were such a close-knit family. This is how we were able to make it. And I'll quote another close reading of a survivor's account of it. going again, it's like a flip side of the coin, which you presented for Radom. This comes from Esther Sturmer of Borshchów in Eastern Galicia, today Ukraine, who wrote a Yiddish memoir that was translated into English, and actually there is a interesting documentary on the story of that family and its survival. But she wrote the following. Our family in particular would not let the Germans have their way easily. We had vigor, ingenuity, and determination to survive. Above all, our family would stand together. When one of us was in danger, the others could not cower to escape. They proved their personal strength and character time and again. Now, we can discuss to what extent there was a causal effect between the strength of the family network, but in individual cases, indeed, that plays a role. One specific example in general for especially East Central Europe is hiding, both in the ghettos and then on the so-called Aryan side, where family members, especially men, take responsibility for wives, sisters, daughters, grandchildren in arranging hiding places. And it's only when men are gone, women take their role. This is this intersectionality between familial and gender lens. They really need to go together. So in one of my favorite cases, Janeta Jaffa Janina Margulies, who is a 40-year-old school teacher and finds herself in Tarnopol, again, Eastern Galicia, Ukraine today. She comes with a husband and a teenage son. They are killed right away, as her parents, her siblings, and she takes on the role of protector of remaining female cousins. She's the one who organizes hiding places. Now, the agency here is limited. In the end, she survives alone, being hidden by a Christian peasant woman after she jumps off the train to Bełżec. But for the time being, again, if we don't fast forward to the end, we see how family network, in her case, puts a burden of responsibility on her for caring for other distant family members. This brings us to the questions of choiceless choices, or this gray zone of impossible choices that people are making. And again, we need that familial lens to fully appreciate it. So as much as there are accounts of staying together, there are also accounts of the moment in which people decide that they need to leave their parents behind, their grandparents behind, that if they stay in the ghetto, if they follow their dear ones, this is simply going to their deaths. So just again, one example, this time in Lviv. You can figure out that I work on Galicia right now. This is from a teenage girl in Lviv ghetto who loses her parents and her older brother, and she's beginning to already swell from hunger. And at some point she decides to leave, try to leave the ghetto, go to Stryj, where the conditions are still much better, to live with distant family, but she leaves a grandmother and a death aunt, and she knows that by leaving them behind, she will never see them again. But she says, I was 16, I wanted to live. This is a testimony that was taken right after the war. So there is the duality between staying together and leaving family members, but also between this tale of solidarity, but also families breaking down. There are accounts of families not sharing food, fathers, for example, stealing food from children, or divorce. Fascinating research that is being done by Michal Unger about divorce in Litzmannstadt ghetto, where men turn out to be useless and their wives are seeking very quick divorce in order to keep limited food supplies for themselves and primarily for the children. So this duality comes to our view when we apply family lens. And there is a research that has just come out. It's literally Warm from the Press, the second volume of a study organized by the Center for Holocaust Research in Warsaw, run by Barbara Engelking, that looks very closely at local cases of Jewish daily life. And Tomasz Frydel, fantastic young historian, has an analysis, a piece on Dębica County, where he comes to a conclusion that where we talk about the choices of Jews during roundups between life and death, in fact, these are choices between life and family. Keeping together with the family means death, leaving family behind. But the lens is necessary to understand the choice. Sarah Cushman, in her forthcoming study of women of Birkenau, comes to the same or mentions the same reflection of women in Birkenau who talk about the fact that family, biological family, having biological family in Birkenau could be both a luxury and a burden. So this duality, again, that takes me to the expanding family networks to surrogate family networks. And I think that, again, these are topics that have been studied, such as adoption of Jewish children by righteous among the nations, or Anna Hajkova's research on barter in terms of sexual relations. But I think that family lens would add another aspect to this topic. I mean, there is a way of looking at it differently now. I'll give you, again, my favorite example, material that I found at USHMM in the archives, a story of Feiga Ginsburg, a young woman from Kolbuszowa, from a religious family, Hasidic family, who finds herself in lucky situation. She comes into contact with a Polish man by the name of Tadeusz Kobyłko, who agrees to bring her to Lwów, to the Aryan side, and help her initially to settle. She settles. A year later, their son is born, and he gets involved not only in caring for her and their child. The child is registered as a Catholic child, baptized and registered, but she's hiding. She doesn't have Aryan papers, but also arranges for her niece to be transferred from the ghetto that has already been since liquidated. And so he is taking care and rescuing two Jewish children, one of whom is his own, and his then not yet wife. Now, what is exactly the nature of this relationship? It's hard to ascertain, but what the USHMM has is a collection of letters that Feiga and Tadeusz exchange after the war. So when the Soviet army comes to Lwów, they actually register as a married couple, as a civil married couple, and they go together from what now becomes the Soviet Union to Poland. They settle in Bytom, as many Jews from Eastern Galicia did. And in August 1946, she takes both children and disappears, and then sends to him a series of letters, heart-wrenching letters, on the way first to Marseille and then to Palestine, Israel. And she tries to explain to him that although she has feelings for him, but their marriage has no future, and in fact, the marriage would have never happened if not for the war. She's in fact older, she must have given him a different date of birth. She's older, she's Jewish, they don't belong together. His responses are increasingly angry, and in the end, he sends quite explicitly anti-Semitic letters complaining about Jewish lack of gratitude. And on the other hand, though, this is a small, intimate history in which if we choose to look at it only as a context of a strategy of survival and barter, I think we lose the element that these two people and the two children, for some brief moment, indeed became a wartime family. 1 minute per two other issues. History of emotions. In personal accounts, we have an abundance of expressions of emotions, and much of it has to do, aside from fear and despair, with the loss of family members. And I don't have time for quotes. But I think that it's interesting to look through the familial lens also when the emotions are suppressed. I'm not quite sure yet what to do with it, but I think it's something to at least think of. And I'll give you one example, forthcoming diary / memoir by Leon Torne, that will be coming out with Rutgers University Press, prepared by Daniel Magillo, where it's 300 pages long, it's very detailed, and the author does not mention the name of his wife, whom she sees captured and taken to the train that will take her to Belzec. The family, the mourning of his wife, his brothers, his mother, his father, is absent. He writes a communal history of the destruction of religious Jewry. And I think that the lack of emotions here is just as telling as explicit statements about it, this expressed and suppressed element that I think needs to be read both through the lens of family and gender. And the last half a paragraph, which is to say that ultimately I think that the familial lens is a perfect example and perspective that would allow for the change of scale that Claire Zahl has called for in Micro History of the Holocaust. As she puts it, it gives increased attention to the categories of actors, the strategies of individuals and small groups, as well as to ways of writing history. So now it's me, with family lens, we gain new insight into problematizing Jewish agency, choices, strategies, emotions, communal patterns, and gender roles, and this is just a short list. Thank you.